Presiding Officer, I would like to raise a serious concern that proper parliamentary procedure has not been followed ahead of these Conservative Party business debates. As you may know, members across the chamber out with the Conservative Party did not have any official advance sight of what the second of today's party business debates would be until after 1 p.m. yesterday, late in the parliamentary working day, and were only informed of the topic of the debate when a pre-prepared briefing from Scottish Lands and Estates and the Scottish Association of Landlords landed in members' inboxes at 3:40 p.m. the day before. Further, the Conservative Party appears to have issued a press release to the media containing details of today's motion before that motion was agreed by the Parliamentary Bureau. That the Conservative Party...
Ms Roddick, can we listen to the member, please, with a degree of respect? Ms Roddick.
That the Conservative Party thought it appropriate to communicate parliamentary business to landlord lobby groups and the press before this Parliament is a matter of profound concern. Indeed, given that the Tory MSP, Stephen Kerr, has previously stated in this chamber that it is a matter of fundamental respect to the Scottish Parliament that business is communicated first to the presiding officer and members, as opposed to the media or interested stakeholders, it is only appropriate that I raise this point of order, requesting an apology from the Scottish Conservatives so that proper democratic process and the integrity of the Scottish Parliament is not further undermined.
Can I thank Ms Roddick for advance notice of her point of order? Well, guidance does determine that the Government must respect the place of Parliament when making announcements. There is no formal arrangement as such in relation to opposition parties. I can, though, inform members that there was a delay on one of the motions being circulated while issues of admissibility were being considered. As a matter of courtesy and respect, however, it would have been preferable had the details of these debates not appeared in the public domain before the wider Parliament was informed of these topics. With that, can we move on to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion 7613 in the name of Miles Brigg on homeless emergency. I would invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible, and I call Miles Briggs to speak to and move the motion. Around 7 minutes, Mr Briggs.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And what is regrettable is the fact that once again it is only because of opposition debating time that Parliament is to be able to debate the crisis facing individuals and families across Scotland today. Deputy Presiding Officer, sometimes in politics the government of the day needs a wake-up call, and ministers need to pause and understand that the government is failing to deliver on its outcomes and indeed is failing the people of Scotland. One such example was the drug deaths crisis facing our country. And as health spokesman for the Conservatives, I led debate after debate in this chamber at the time when the Cabinet Secretary was actually Cabinet Secretary for Health, warning ministers that they needed to stop and understand where drug deaths had escalated to in this country and the crisis facing individuals, families and drug services across our country. That fell on deaf ears as ministers parroted out the same line saying that everything was fine, the opposition parties were wrong. Indeed, very much like the Scottish Government's amendment for today's debate. But the reality on the ground was very different, and the result being that in Scotland we now see a record number of our fellow Scots dying from drug-related deaths, which has escalated year on year under this government. Now, after SNP ministers cut the drug budget and following outrage from the public, the First Minister accepted that SNP ministers had taken their eye off the ball and were finally forced to pause and declare a public health emergency. The same, I am sorry to say, is the case for homeless people across Scotland today and the housing emergency which our country faces. After 15 years in office, it is clear that we are facing a homeless emergency and a housing crisis. And it's not just Scottish Conservatives who are saying that and calling for action. Shelter Scotland have repeatedly called on ministers to declare a housing emergency. I'd like to thank those organisations, including Shelter, who provided helpful briefings ahead of today's debate, but also very much for the life-saving work which they undertake across all our communities, especially here in the capital. And it is no exaggeration to say that this SNP Green government is indeed presiding over a national housing crisis. Whilst much of the media attention recently has focused, understandably, on the SNP Green minister's abject failures in health and education, the housing emergency has for far too long gone under the radar, but it is very real and demands urgent government action today. Presiding Officer, I believe it is completely unacceptable that in Scotland today there are 47,000 people currently registered as homeless, and 250,000 of Scots on social housing waiting lists, including close to 100,000 children. Just think about that, 100,000 children and more than 24,000 disabled people. There are also more than 600 armed service veterans registered as homeless today, something which should not just embarrass us all as a nation, but more importantly, should shame this SNP Green government into action. And perhaps more... Yes, very briefly.
Graham Day.
Issue of being shamed and taking responsibility, does he accept that the principal responsibility for armed forces veterans lies with the UK government and the MOD?
Miles Briggs.
And the responsibility for housing lies exactly with this member and the government as well in this parliament. And this is what this debate is all about. But as I was going on to say, tragically as well, last year we saw one of the highest numbers of deaths amongst people experiencing homelessness as well. And since this SNP government took office, they have failed to meet all their home building targets on time. And there's little hope of the situation improving when we see John Swinney's most recent budget outlining an additional £170 million cuts in the housing budget. As Shelter Scotland say, we are deeply concerned at the significant 16% cut to the housing budget in 23-24, which has the potential to completely derail the Scottish Government's ability to reduce housing need in this parliamentary term. On top of that, we've seen this government with policy interventions which are also being counterproductive in the housing sector as well and damaging for tenants in the long term as well, ultimately reducing private rental stock and leading to housing developments being paused and shelved. It all adds up to a perfect storm and it cannot be allowed to continue. Deputy Presiding Officer, the fact is that in Scotland today, every 18 minutes, a household becomes homeless. Last year in Scotland, 13,945 households were living in temporary accommodation, with 14,372 children made homeless last year. This needs to change, and it starts with ministers accepting that they have failed to deliver solutions over the last 15 years they have been in office. Deputy Presiding Officer, the housing emergency in Scotland has never been about houses. It's about people. It's about the young family renting a rundown flat, wondering if they'll ever be able to afford a home of their own. It's about the record number of children in Scotland today living in emergency temporary accommodation, forced to change schools every time that they move. It's about the failure of this SNP Green government to actually meet their affordable home targets. And it's very much about the need for a Scottish government that at the very least acknowledges the housing emergency and for an all-government approach to start developing the solutions we desperately need. Deputy Presiding Officer, I believe the housing policy decisions being taken by this SNP Green government are now making the housing emergency worse in Scotland today. It is time for this SNP Green government to pause and to reflect on the fact that Scotland is facing a housing emergency, and for this Parliament to collectively act to save lives and also to work to give everyone in Scotland the same and safe home that they deserve. I move the motion in my name.
Thank you very much, Mr. Briggs. I now call on the Cabinet Secretary to speak to and move Amendment 7613.2 for around 6 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. You would have thought from that speech that the Tory cost of living crisis has no impact on people's ability to afford their home or indeed the increase in homelessness. And the fact there was not a reference to the cost of living crisis really tells the Chamber everything they need to know about the motivation for this debate. Presiding Officer, it is a national priority of this Scottish Government to tackle homelessness, end rough sleeping and transform temporary housing, and our ambition to ensure everyone has a safe and warm place to call home. I'm proud that this country has some of the strongest homelessness legislation in the world for people experiencing or at risk of experiencing homelessness, and we are going further. Local authorities already have a legal duty to provide advice and assistance to anyone at risk of homelessness, and people have access to permanent accommodation in law. We also announced last week that we would introduce prevention duties in our forthcoming housing bill, and we will introduce a right to housing in our planned human rights legislation. Our proposals for a human rights bill will seek to incorporate the right of everyone to an adequate standard of living, including the right to adequate housing, as far as possible within devolved competence. Ensuring people are aware of their rights and when to exercise them is an important part of building the Scotland that we want to see. We also propose new duties on public bodies to ask and act to prevent homelessness, so that prevention of homelessness is key and the risk of homelessness is acted on regardless of the service first approached. This is key to our no wrong door approach, and taking a joined up and early intervention approach aims to strengthen existing practice, improve consistency and deliver long term savings and benefits to services, as well as reducing instances of homelessness. Presiding Officer, let me now turn to the issue of temporary accommodation. And whilst the latest statistics show the use of temporary accommodation in 20 local authority areas has actually gone down, I am well aware that there are far too many households in temporary accommodation at the moment. The majority of households in temporary accommodation are in council or housing association homes, with two-thirds of families with children in temporary accommodation in social rented homes. I am particularly concerned at the increase in the number of children in temporary accommodation. However, the Scottish Government is firmly committed to reducing this, and that's why, of course, we established an expert task and finish group chaired by Shelter Scotland, who I would also want to pay tribute to their work, and with the Association of Local Authority Chief Housing Officers. That group is expected to deliver its final report next month, which will make recommendations on homelessness services, social housing and managing the current stock. They will bring forward innovative ways in which to reduce the numbers in temporary accommodation and the length of time households spend there. And this will enable us to support those areas with challenges and ensure they can learn from others who have made progress. Yes.
Jamie Green.
Thank you to the Cabinet Secretary. The simple question is, why are so many in temporary accommodation and why are they in it for so long? Because that's a question we should already know the answer to.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, a lot of work has gone on to really get underneath why people end up in temporary accommodation, and those are multiple reasons. Partly, the increase has been through COVID, and people were taken into temporary accommodation. There was a big jump in temporary accommodation use for all of the reasons that we understand. The cost of living crisis is without doubt having an impact, and we need to get the supply right. And the member will be aware of the pause to the construction industry, the cost of inflation, everything, the materials, labour. It has put pressure on projects, but we maintain our commitment to 110,000 homes by 2032, the £3.5 billion investment over this parliamentary term, and working with partners to make sure that not just the supply of new builds, but the acquisition of existing properties off market can help to move people in to settled accommodation. In the time I've got left, I want to talk about the actions since the 2018 recommendations of our Homelessness and Rough Sleeping Action Group, which we accepted in full and informs our Ending Homelessness Together action plan, published in 2018 and refreshed in 2020. And the plan is supported by stakeholders and ensures we're working in partnership to reduce and prevent homelessness. We are doing what they have asked us to do, and it's making good progress. The number of people sleeping rough in Scotland continues to fall. We've taken important steps towards strengthening rights for tenants and preventing homelessness, and we're leading the way in the delivery of affordable homes far more than anywhere else within these islands. Where homelessness does occur, the Scottish Government continues to promote a housing-led approach with a focus on rapidly rehousing people in settled accommodation, and that's why we're providing local authorities with £52.5 million for rapid rehousing and Housing First to ensure that people are given a settled place to live as soon as possible. Our actions are backed by funding of over £100 million to 25-26 with two action plans. Presiding Officer, I'm well aware that the current cost of living crisis places people at more risk of homelessness, which is why this Government took action to support people in the rented sector through our Cost of Living Tenant Protection Scotland Act, which I'm sure we'll talk about more in the next debate. We've also taken more actions that I'll touch on further in my closing speech. Presiding officer, no one in Scotland should be at risk of homelessness, and we'll do all we can to prevent it and support people. But it's also the case for people who are at risk of destitution because of their immigration status. It's very disturbing that the UK government do not allow people with no recourse to public funds to access homelessness support and other essential services, something that could be changed urgently, and I would urge them to do that. I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Mark Griffin to speak to and move Amendment 7613.1, up to 6 minutes, please, Mr Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. For the purpose of this debate and the following debate, draw members' attention to my register of interest, which shows that I'm owner of a private rented property in the North Lanarkshire Council area. We welcome today's debate on Scotland's homelessness emergency and will support the motion at decision time today. Last February, the Cabinet Secretary led a debate on the prevention of homeless duties, speaking about our world-leading legislation, the £100 million Ending Homelessness Together Fund and our refreshed action plan. But since then, though, the situation has gotten worse. Applications are up, and so are the number of children in temporary accommodation. Families who simply want the right to safe, secure, affordable housing with the stability they need for a normal work life, a school life, or a normal family life, but instead they're going without that most basic need. And during that debate last year, countless colleagues raised the issue of council budget cuts affecting the ability of councils to tackle the crisis. And those decisions have consequences. Here in Edinburgh, where the homelessness crisis is at its worst in terms of gross numbers, the council is running out of road in dealing with the crisis. In November, it reported a projected homelessness gap.
Mr. Griffin. Mr. Griffin, you can continue.
In November, it reported projected homelessness gap of £19 million, doubling year on year. Today, Ewan Aitken, the Chief Executive of Cyrenians, reports rough sleeping numbers in Edinburgh are back to 30 to 40 a night. A third...
Yep. Cabinet Secretary.
I wonder if the member, he raises an important point, I wonder if he would recognise that a lot of that, though, is driven by people with no recourse to public funds who are destitute. Now, it's an issue we need to resolve. The UK government has to also help resolve that matter. But if you look at who that increase relates to, unfortunately, a number of them are asylum seekers and people with no recourse to public funds, and we need to sort that.
Mark Griffin.
Yeah, it's clearly an area that they need to sort, and the Cabinet Secretary will know from our time on the Social Security Committee in the last session that this party is firmly committed to see reform of that no recourse to public funds, especially when it comes to the wider Social Security. If that's a contributing factor to that, that needs to be dealt with urgently, but it's clearly not the only factor, and there are others who are part of that increasing number of people who are rough sleeping. But also in this city, a third of those in temporary accommodation across this whole country are in this city, and they stay in temporary accommodation for almost a year. Further afield, a number equivalent to the whole population of Stirling made a homeless application last year. And children included on those applications, about 13,000, is the same as all of the children in St Andrews. Presiding Officer, I note the Cabinet Secretary's amendment about supply figures, and I'm sure we'll touch on that more in the next debate. But in short, I agree with my colleague, Miles Briggs, that the government have taken their eye off the ball on housing. The Tenants' Rights Minister last week confirmed this government has run out of steam with neither the will or the skill to tackle the homelessness emergency. The bandwidth the government claimed to deliver new homelessness duties, including on this government, was used to pass the rent freeze and evictions moratorium legislation. So that then delays the housing bill further into the autumn. Our amendment calls on the government to get serious on homelessness by designating a single housing minister with overall and direct responsibility for tackling Scotland's housing emergency and meeting people's housing needs. That's a call that's backed by the social sector, by the house building industry, by a wide range of those with an interest in the sector, because housing and homelessness needs to be reprioritised by this government, because the current arrangements are not delivering. Those prevention duties are needed now, including on the government, because it seems to be contributing to homelessness. A government that thought £2,500 was a reasonable level of arrears to evict. A government that 4 months ago announced an extension to the Tenant Grant Fund eligibility, but refused to renew funding and only updated the rules 2 weeks ago. Now, when statistics show that 14 councils have spent upwards of their allocation and 19 have less than 10% remaining, who then is that fund left to help keep a roof over their heads? And, Presiding Officer, time and time again, the government has shown that it doesn't have the capacity, that it's not serious about tackling this emergency. It even deleted the word emergency from the motion today. Another issue that I raised with the Minister during the passage of the rent freeze bill, and we met and discussed, was the issue of in-situ purchases. Now, I feel that that's urgent and we need to see progress, because landlords and their agencies and representatives keep telling us that they are looking to sell up. So why then are grant rules for the housing supply programme not designed to acquire those tenancies and stock? It could help landlords seek an exit, but it could also keep people in a home.
No, I'm afraid he's just winding up. He's beyond his time already.
I'd be happy to meet again and talk to the government, particularly on that issue. But the case remains that this requires for a home to be made vacant, and for that to be achieved, someone is likely to be made homelessness. But I realise I'm fast running out of time, but fundamentally, council needs the funding to tackle this issue properly, and I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Mr Griffin. I now call Willie Rennie for up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Rennie.
Action plans, action groups, task and finish groups, rights to a home, joined up work and no wrongdoer. I mean, this is a spaghetti soup of a plan. The reality is we've got a crisis, and the slick presentation of policy does not build any new homes. To be fair, there is new housing I've seen in my constituency. We've seen it in Garbridge, in Galdrey, and also in St Monans. But it's the first developments of the type for some time. And it hides the reality that the government is in trouble on meeting its housing targets. I think the Minister actually indicated that within her contribution, that she's behind on the pace of progress that needs to be made. The SFHA have rightly pointed out there's been a 16% cut in new starts, that there's only 5,000 homes been built so far. We need to get to 100... I'll just finish this point. We need to build 110,000 homes by 2032. They reckon by 2026 we need to build 38,000, and we're not on track for any of that. I'll take an intervention from the Minister.
Well, the sector will also have told Willie Rennie, though, that the key issues are COVID recovery, the cost of materials and labour, Brexit, and indeed the inflation running rampant through costs. I'm sure they have told him, because that's what they've told me. Those are the key issues. Willie Rennie.
Yes, of course, but she needs to build the houses or people won't get the homes. So what action is she going to take to address that, rather than just complaining about somebody else making mistakes elsewhere? What action is she taking herself, other than all the sound bites of the slogans that she gave me earlier on, and especially when she's considering making a £112 million cut to the capital budget to build homes? That's not a response to all of the issues she rightly identified in her contribution and my intervention. So the action that the government's taking as a result of this crisis does not match the problems that we are facing, because demand is huge. I've seen people living in animated suspension for years on end, desperate for a home. They don't have enough points. They've maybe got 40, 50 points. Nowhere near the 100 points. Even those on 100 points don't get a home. And thousands are in that situation for years upon end. That's no way to live a life or build a family. And if you look at the number of children in temporary accommodation, again, life in suspension. Those numbers have doubled, and you can wait for up to 2 years in temporary accommodation. So I wasn't surprised that Shelter took Fife Council to court in Kirkcaldy just last year. I wasn't surprised they did that, because they were infuriated that families were in that position for so long, and they succeeded. And I can tell you, Fife Housing is now in utter chaos, desperate to get new temporary accommodation, because all that temporary accommodation has been turned into permanent accommodation. It's good for those families. For everybody else, it's going to be a challenge. But what has been the response from the government? Not one single thing. Not one response to that successful court case. We need a government that gets real about the problems on housing in this country, because people, unlike everybody in this chamber who has a home, people are desperate out there to get something. And it's been going on and building up for years upon end. But the government's response, £112 million cut to the capital fund to build homes. It's way behind on its target to build 110,000 homes by 2032. But you wouldn't think that from the response from the Minister. I think she needs to get real.
Thank you, Mr Rennie. We will now move to the open debate, speeches of up to 4 minutes, and I call Jeremy Balfour to be followed by Emma Roddick. Mr Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It's undeniable that we are facing an emergency when it comes to housing. There can be no dispute that the situation has spiralled out of control with this SNP Green government. Since Nicola Sturgeon came to power, the number of households living in temporary accommodation has increased just over 10,000 people to almost 14,000. In the past year, the number of homeless households and homeless applications in Scotland have both increased by 3%, and applications have taken an average of 19 days to be assessed, and yet this government is cutting local government funding. Even after they've eventually processed many homeless families in my region of Lothian, I've been sent 150 miles away to emergency accommodation in Inverness. There's almost 100,000 children on Scotland's social housing waiting list. 21st century SNP Scotland. That number is simply unacceptable. There are currently over 24,000 people with disabilities on social housing waiting lists. And the longest a person with a disability had been waiting on a council list is 60 years. 60 years. An FOI from Edinburgh City Council read, the longest waiting time a self-assessed disabled applicant has had on the Common Housing Register for social housing was 1st March 1963. Deputy Presiding Officer, what we would call this is an emergency, or perhaps even worse, an embarrassment to this government. This government should be ashamed. Ashamed that each of these numbers represent an individual or a household that has been let down. Ashamed that we represent a staggering number of children who don't enjoy safety and security of a stable and warm home. And ashamed that we are seemingly doing nothing to fix it. Warm words don't build houses. I'm afraid I don't have time. But this is not a new emergency. We've heard yet again from the Cabinet Secretary blaming everybody but herself and her government. But the writing has been on the wall for a number of years. The government has consistently missed its house building targets, allowing the supply of quality, affordable housing to plummet during their time in power. And Deputy Presiding Officer, I'm afraid that the outlook for the near future is not much better. With the introduction and new extension of rent control measures, we are already seeing the knock-on effects of policies that stop landlords from renting out their properties. I'm already hearing from a number of stakeholders in my region of Lothian, and particularly here in Edinburgh, that they are saying they are no longer going to do this as a viable option, and they're going to sell, further reducing the number of homes available for those who need it. And let us be clear, those who are bearing the cost of these policies are not wealthy companies who could potentially afford a price freeze. It's smaller-scale landlords who simply cannot afford to continue renting their properties out while losing money, and the most vulnerable in our society who cannot find a stable place to live due to the sinking market. I hope the Scottish Government will wake up, will take a long look hard at itself, because the responsibility of this emergency lies squarely at one person's feet, the Scottish Government, and no one else. Yeah. Thank you, Deputy President Officer.
Thank you, Mr Balfour. I now call Emma Roddick to be followed by Maggie Chapman. Ms Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Many will know that I have a personal interest in the topic of homelessness and a lived understanding of it and how important it is to tackle. I know that you lose a lot when you're homeless. That could be possessions, security, or even your sense of self. But homelessness is not a given. It's a symptom of something else. It's evidence that someone has fallen through a net. Maybe they have to wait 6 weeks before they get a universal credit payment. Maybe they lost their job due to shameful UK employment rates. Or maybe they were failed by insecure housing. And despite what the Tories will try to tell us later today, this can't be addressed solely by building more homes. But the Scottish Government is building more homes, delivering nearly 113,000 affordable homes since 2007, and it's committed to £3.5 billion of spending on the Affordable Housing Supply Programme. But all of that is made harder when our colleagues in the Conservatives insist on propping up a UK government that has just cut our capital spend on housing by 3.4% in real terms. More importantly, the SNP government is taking a progressive approach to tackling homelessness, looking at the drivers and preventative measures and increasing affordable housing availability by tackling the loss of residential properties to holiday lets and second homes, keeping people in the homes they've already got and supporting people who are in or at risk of ending up in poverty. And we've recently seen some great steps forward being taken in this Parliament. Licensing for short-term lets, which are eating up housing in communities across my region, like many of those in Skye, which Conservatives voted against, the rent freeze, which Conservatives voted against, and a moratorium on evictions, which the Conservatives voted against. And we have to be clear. Yes, I will.
I'm grateful for the member for taking this intervention. Will she realise that both these pieces of legislation have had to firstly be challenged by bodies outside of this Parliament, but also that the Government have had to delay another piece of the legislation by 6 months because it's unworkable by councils?
Emma Roddick.
I think that the period of time between now and when the Housing Bill is introduced is exactly why emergency legislation was brought forward, and I just think it's a shame that the Conservatives wouldn't support this interim measure, which we know is already supporting people to stay in the houses that they have. Now, we have to be clear that the biggest drivers of poverty here today, housing costs, food costs, are linked to inflation. Inflation which has been caused by reckless UK government decisions. My constituents are paying the price, and a steep one, for preposterous levels of Tory economic mismanagement. Inflation is eating up the Scottish Government's budget and the budgets of households across the country, no matter how well off they were just a year ago. With the best will in the world, that can't be entirely undone by a devolved government, especially one up against an increasingly litigious Whitehall, which stands ready to knock back legislation that it doesn't like. And we're all getting used to it, and it seems almost normal, but if you take a step back, you realise it is a ridiculous concept, that we're making decisions here, progressive decisions like the rent freeze, New Deal for tenants, anti-poverty measures like the Scottish Child Payment, but doing all that within a financial context that's been set by a right-wing Tory government elsewhere, one whose ideas have been overwhelmingly voted down by Scotland over and over again. It's a nonsense, and at this point, the UK looks like a rejected idea for a political dystopian novel. Everything we do comes with a but. Here in Scotland, the average first-time buyer spends around £100,000 less for a property than in England. But mortgage rates rose substantially after the UK government's mini-budget last year. The Scottish Government is tackling poverty with the Scottish Child Payment, Welfare Fund and more. But the UK Tories insist on a 5-week wait for universal credit, more sanctions than ever before, a benefit cap and a penalty for being under 25. The Scottish Government is introducing duties to prevent homelessness, but UK Government decisions keep pushing folk towards it by making life more expensive.
Ms Roddick, could I ask you to bring your remarks to a close because your time has passed?
However bold and ambitious our housing policy, Scotland is at the mercy of UK Government decisions, and this only reinforces the urgent need for independence.
Thank you, Ms Roddick. I now call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Fulton McGregor. Ms Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to begin by thanking all those across Scotland who work day after day, night after night, to prevent homelessness and support those at risk of homelessness or who are homeless. In particular, I'd like to thank Crisis and Shelter, who do this work and have provided briefings in advance of today. It is important, I think, to acknowledge just how connected having and staying in a home is to so many other aspects of life. Health and well-being, social care, employment, and so on. Tackling homelessness is not just about providing homes. We do have a problem with homelessness in Scotland, and I don't think anyone here is trying to deny that. It should be obvious that the pandemic and the current cost crisis certainly have not helped. But what is very clear, indeed, Shelter says this explicitly, and I quote, "The housing emergency has been with us since long before the COVID pandemic hit and long before the current cost of living crisis. Decades of political and economic choices have led us to where we are today." I know I'm not alone in thinking that the Tories have cynically appropriated the Shelter campaign. Miles Briggs has called on the Cabinet Secretary to acknowledge the scale of the problem and outline immediate plans to tackle homelessness and accelerate home building. But if you look at what Shelter's plan actually says, it is quite clear. And again, I quote, "Any effort to address the housing needs of people in Scotland will work best if the UK government also uses its powers to improve the benefit system and tackle energy prices." End quote. Shelter has called for the end of all subsidy for home ownership projects and mid-market rent. The plan says we should, and again, I quote, "redirect all subsidy from the Scottish Government's affordable housing supply programme exclusively to homes for social rent. Public subsidy should only go to social housing." Shelter is saying that the more than £1 billion investment earmarked for private developers and home ownership support should all go to the not-for-profit sector. In their words, at a time when costs of delivering social housing have risen dramatically, it can no longer be justified to divert finite public subsidy to benefit private sector developers. Shelter's campaign also highlights the damage to our housing supply done by the Tory flagship policy, supported by successive Westminster governments, the Right to Buy. This removed nearly 500,000 homes from the social sector. Shelter is calling for the appropriation of empty homes in the private sector, directing them to those in need. Like Shelter, I believe that homes should be for living in, not for profit. I don't think anyone thinks that the party opposite genuinely believes this. I've yet to hear anyone in the Conservative Party back all of Shelter's proposals. And let's look at how the Conservative UK government has exacerbated the issue for more than a decade. Their attack on social security, the bedroom tax, the benefit cap, cuts to universal credit, freezing of the local housing allowance, and so much more. Austerity, their relentless campaign of othering and marginalising people seeking asylum, and their continued opposition to deal with the loss of homes to holiday lets or the second homes market. These all paint a very clear picture of Tory priorities for society. So while claiming to care about the homelessness crisis, they have consistently acted in ways that make it worse. So what we need is action. And that is what the Scottish Greens, through the Bute House Agreement with the Scottish Government, are doing and will continue to do. We will tackle empty homes and increase availability of homes in rural areas. We will embed homelessness prevention and housing rights in law. We are already delivering housing first with local authorities and protecting people from eviction and extortionate rent hikes. And there is more to come. Yes, we have our work cut out for us. No, none of this will be easy. But it is right that we work to deliver homes for living in, not homes for profit, and that we tackle homelessness in the round, ensuring all of the elements of support are accessible and available to those who need it. I do not think the Conservative Party opposite can say the same.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms Chapman. I now call Fulton McGregor to be followed by Sharon Dowie. Mr McGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The issue of homelessness is one that unfortunately affects people and families across every city, town and village in Scotland. As we've heard already from the Cabinet Secretary, it is an objective of the Scottish Government for everyone
in this country to have a safe, warm and affordable home that meets the requirements. And the numbers, as we've also heard, are of course indeed stark just now. According to Crisis, the National Charity for People Experiencing Homelessness, they received 35,230 applications for assistance from homeless households in 21-22. And a few months ago, they conducted a survey which firmly highlighted the role that the cost of living crisis has played in exacerbating the homelessness issues we are speaking about today. The survey found that almost half of respondents had mortgage or rent increases in the previous 12 months. Just under 10% of low-income renters in Scotland are behind in their rent. But perhaps most shockingly, a third of respondents in Scotland acknowledge that they will likely need to skip meals to keep up with housing costs. The cost of living crisis is affecting everyone, but it must be highlighted that it is disproportionately impacting those on the lowest incomes. This includes tenants who are already struggling with housing costs, people out of work and people who are unable to work for reasons out of their control. People in these households already find it very hard to manage rising bills. Any further financial pressure will no doubt push more people towards homelessness. And the simple fact is that we are all in this country paying the price for grotesque economic mismanagement at the hands of the Tory government in Westminster. Now, the Tory members will say, well, you're just looking for somebody else to blame, but they're the cold, hard facts. And I have to give credit to the Conservative Party for bringing this forward, because they can't be accused of playing in safe ground anyway. So far, inflation has soared to its highest level in nearly 40 years, hitting 10.5% in December. Brexit has added almost £6 billion to UK food bills in the 2 years to the end of 2021, disproportionately affecting the poorest households. And I see that Mark Carney was out again today criticising the Brexit decision on the UK economy. And in response to the autumn statement last November, the Institute for Fiscal Studies noted that the UK was now reaping the costs of a long-term failure to grow the economy, which was worsened by a series of economic own goals by the UK government. And while I could continue to list ways in which we are all suffering due to the Tory economic mismanagement, I will instead comment on ways that this government have yet again sought to mitigate against these economic woes inflicted upon us. People renting their homes will be among the hardest hit. Tenants, especially in the private rented sector, spend a greater proportion of their income on housing than people who own their own homes. And as we've heard already, the Scottish Government took decisive action, legislated accordingly and introduced both a rent freeze and a moratorium on evictions. The aim of this bill was to protect tenants during the cost crisis. And I should also add that Tories in this chamber were the only party to vote against these measures being introduced. In addition, the Scottish Government have also extended the eligibility criteria for a tenant grant fund, which allowed local authorities to use any remaining funds to help households with arrears resulting from the cost of living crisis. And other measures include the £84 million in the budget for discretionary housing payments in order to directly ease the impact of UK government policies, such as, of course, the bedroom tax. The Scottish Government are also investing £2.6 million to mitigate the benefit cap, helping over 4,000 families meet their housing costs. And this all in addition to policies like the Scottish Child Payments, which I know will make a great difference to many of my constituents in Coatbridge and Crison. It's actually ironic, presiding officer, that I'm coming up to 4 minutes and I've still actually got loads to say.
I'm afraid,
about
Mr. McGregor, will have to be saved for another day because you will need to conclude. Thank you.
Thank you, presiding officer. In conclusion, try as this Scottish Government might to help combat poverty and homelessness, their actions are consistently undermined by the UK Government's frankly cruel welfare policies, which actively push people into poverty. We are at the mercy of this UK Government decisions, and this, in my view, and increasingly it would seem that of many others.
Mr. McGregor, I had asked you to conclude, so that really means conclude. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you. I now call Sharon Dowie to be followed by Colette Stevenson. I just would advise members we have no time in hand. So Sharon Dowie followed by Colette Stevenson. Ms. Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. At the outset, let me make this clear. Whatever words the SNP Government chooses to use to make this situation sound better than it is, Scotland is in a housing emergency on their watch. 330,000 Scots are stuck on social housing waiting lists, including nearly 100,000 children. There are almost 47,000 homeless people nationally, and there are almost 14,000 households in temporary accommodation, according to Scottish Government figures. Those numbers are so big that they're hard to even comprehend, never mind tackle. But behind every one of those figures are real people. Some of the most vulnerable in our society, including hundreds of veterans and many disabled people forced onto the street, struggling families who need urgent help to make ends meet, young children growing up without a stable home and a roof over their head. The most worrying thing is that the number of people needing help is rising. This situation is getting worse, not better. The number of homeless applications from adults and children is rising, and homeless applications are taking longer to deal with. And the number of homeless people dying has gone up by an estimated 50%. This is not just a housing emergency, it's a national tragedy. And all of that is happening while there are more than 55,000 domestic properties across Scotland unoccupied, homes lying empty that could be in use. That should be a wake-up call to SNP ministers that something is deeply wrong with their approach. This failure... Will I get my time back?
I'm afraid there isn't any time, so you'd have to absorb... The member would have to absorb the intervention.
No, sorry. This failure is the consequence of years of missing affordable home targets and broken promises to build enough homes for the social rented sector. It's what happens when the SNP government takes its eye off the ball, just as it did with Scotland's drug death crisis. These national tragedies are linked. For all its talk of tackling poverty, the SNP government has forgotten so many of Scotland's most deprived communities and most vulnerable people. SNP ministers live in a Holyrood bubble that seems to ignore the reality of what happens in working-class communities across Scotland. The First Minister grew up in Ayrshire, but she's not done anywhere near enough to help people who still live there now. Shelter Scotland have said Nicola Sturgeon should spearhead a Scottish Housing Emergency Action Plan, and she must listen. But it can't stop at just another plan or strategy or national mission. The SNP government needs to do more than get a few good headlines. Mm-hmm. A nice press release won't put a roof over anyone's head. Some PR soundbites won't give people the homes they deserve and need. For once, the government needs to commit to a clear target and actually deliver it. A realistic target with a clear, well-funded and smart plan to deliver it. That plan must produce more homes, especially affordable homes and social housing. It must reduce the bureaucratic hurdles and the issues that people face when trying to build. It must slash the red tape preventing empty business premises in some areas from becoming good quality homes. And it must produce a framework to bring long-term unoccupied properties back into use. Most of all, the government must support Miles Briggs' motion and treat this dire situation as a housing emergency. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Dowie. And I now call Colette Stevenson, who will be the final speaker in the open debate. Ms. Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government's vision is for everyone to have a safe, warm and affordable home that meets their needs. Since 2007, the SNP in government has built over 110,000 affordable homes and is working towards delivering another 110,000 homes by 2032. In recent years, we've invested millions to prioritise settled accommodation for all and introduced rapid rehousing transition plans. Councils have duties to anyone experiencing or threatened with homelessness to provide advice and temporary accommodation. While there's a large number of homeless people in Scotland, there is an important statistic to note. 20 years ago, 10% of people had been rough sleeping the night before their homeless application. Last year, that figure was down to 4%. That is welcome progress, but we can't be complacent. Scotland has powerful protections in place for people experiencing homelessness, but as is often the case, the best way to end homelessness is to prevent it from happening in the first place. The Scottish Government will introduce new prevention duties in its forthcoming housing bill, and I hope all members will support these. That's the SNP record. Now let's look at the Tories. Last week, Miles Briggs highlighted the ambition for affordable No, I have no time on hand. Ambition for affordable housing in National Planning Framework 4, something the Conservatives voted against. When the Parliament approved the 2014 Housing Act, which abolished the right to buy to keep up to 15,500 homes in the social sector over the following decade, the Tories voted against that. With spiralling energy and food prices, the Scottish Government chose to implement a rent freeze to protect tenants and prevent homelessness. But the Tories voted against that too. Thankfully, the Tories are outnumbered by progressives in this Parliament. But, unfortunately, Scotland also has a UK Tory government we didn't vote for. A UK government that will veto Scottish Parliament laws, prioritises cutting taxes for the wealthy and has destroyed the economy and let inflation run away, something which will push more people into poverty. But to reduce homelessness, we must tackle poverty. Many employers in Scotland now pay the living wage, meaning people earn enough to cover the cost of living. The UK government has the power to make this the legal minimum wage, but they choose not to. The Scottish Government introduced the Scottish Child Payment, a game changer in tackling child poverty, but then the UK Government cut universal credit. When the Tories introduced the bedroom tax, the SNP mitigated this, but this means the public purse in Scotland is paying the price of the UK Government's disgraceful decisions. This Parliament can only do so much with one hand tied behind our back. So, Presiding Officer, it's a strange topic for the Conservatives to raise. The Tory UK government's policies are causing misery and hardship on people right across the country. And their voting record in this Parliament is loaded against supporting tenants and keeping people in their homes. The Scottish Government will continue to invest in social and affordable housing and mitigate the worst effects of the UK Government's policies. But the best way forward for Scotland is for this Parliament to have the full fiscal powers and levers needed so that we can get rid of Tory governments we didn't vote for, end homelessness and build a fairer, more prosperous country. And that can only be achieved by independence.
Thank you, Ms Stevenson. And we will now move to closing speeches. I note that one member who had participated in the debate is not in the chamber for closing speeches, which is a discourtesy to all other members. So I would expect that member to be duly advised and to make an apology. And I call on Pam Duncan-Glancy to wind up on behalf of Scottish Labour. Up to 5 minutes, please, Ms Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. A warm, safe, affordable and accessible home is a human right. But for too many people, as we've heard today, in Glasgow and across Scotland, this is not a reality. Glasgow has the fastest increasing rate of homelessness in the country. Last year, there were nearly 7,000 homeless applications to the City Council, and this has been getting worse every year since 2017. As the cost of living crisis drives more people into homelessness, I genuinely fear for the lives of people across the region if this is not addressed. Indeed, as research from Crisis found, a third of respondents in Scotland will need to skip meals to keep up with housing costs this winter. People are being forced to choose between heating and eating, and in Scotland in 2023, that is shameful. Urgent action is needed, and that starts by making more homes available. There is simply not enough housing to meet demand. In response, the SNP raided the house building budget, cutting off supply when we needed it the most. It's not good enough. Presiding Officer, my region of Glasgow has one of the longest wait lists for housing in Scotland. In 2019, there were 20,000 people waiting for a home in the city, and figures consistently rising, as Sharon Dowie has noted. And whilst I appreciate the impact of COVID on construction, the truth is that there are not enough homes being built to meet the demand, and this was a problem before COVID. We cannot address this by building fewer homes, and with the number of new homes being built dropping by a third, I worry that people will be left out in the cold for years to come. We urgently need to get back on track, and I agree with Willie Rennie that the action does not meet the challenge. The Government must make good on its commitment to deliver affordable homes by 2032 and address the fact we need homes for people now. 10 years is a long time for anyone, but if you don't have a roof over your head, it can feel like a lifetime. For some, it could well be a lifetime. They cannot afford to wait for this Government to get its act together. Presiding officer, the impact of the housing crisis is stark. As Miles Briggs said, this is about people, though. We see it every day on our streets. Not having a roof over your head or living in inadequate housing robs people of dignity, can lead to physical and mental ill health. People without homes can't struggle to access healthcare. They have nowhere to register for a GP and they have no address to apply for work from. And it can even lead to an early death. Life expectancy of a homeless woman is 43 years old. The lost opportunity is devastating. And I agree with my colleague Emma Roddick's characterisation that it is a symptom of failure. Presiding officer, against this backdrop, there are incredible third sector organisations in Glasgow and across Scotland stepping in to support people. Shelter Scotland, Glasgow Centre for Inclusive Living, Housing Options Scotland, Living Rent and the Homeless Project Scotland, to name a few. They work tirelessly to represent and organise tenants, find homes and, in the case of the Homeless Project Scotland, feed people. We're so lucky to have them all, and I, like Maggie Chapman and others, want to pay on record today my thanks to them now. But they too are struggling. Sadly, though, for one organisation in my region, the Council and the SNP Government are far from helping them. They're making it worse. The Homeless Project Scotland provide an invaluable service to people in Glasgow. I've visited them several times and I've seen it for myself. I've been blown away by the work they do and the people they help. They've been trying for months to find premises to allow them to carry out their vital work. And so far, the Council have been difficult at best and obstructive at worst. They desperately need a building. If people must rely on such services for food, the least we can do is make sure they eat their meals in dignity and in shelter. I've previously written to the First Minister about this, and I've repeatedly called on the Government and the Council to do more to find a premise for them. Far from help, I was concerned to learn that a spokesperson from the Council has been quoted in various news outlets stating that Homeless Project Scotland has been offered and rejected three offers of accommodation, but the project themselves say this is not true. So I hope that going forward all correspondence on this will be honest and transparent. And then worse still today, the project have reported the shocking news of more and more children queuing up, including in prams. For over a year now, they've been doing this outside. And so I ask again that the Cabinet Secretary act to find them a building so that the people they help don't have to spend another night eating in the cold. Presiding officer, if the First Minister does visit them, she'll see the work for herself. She'll also see that they are helping more women and children and disabled people than before. And as with all crises, people facing inequality, as my colleague Jeremy Balfour has outlined, are hit the hardest. Presiding officer, in closing, the picture is bleak, but there is some good news. There are steps that the Scottish Government can take. And as is often the case, local activists, women, disabled people, homeless people themselves and third sector organisations have the solutions. The Government must step up and tackle the housing crisis. As the motion in my colleague Mark Griffin's name says, it must make a right to housing a reality by designating a single housing minister with direct responsibility to tackle the housing emergency. It must reverse the delay to the proposed housing bill. It must embed women's rights in all housing policy and strategy and take urgent action to ensure accessible homes are delivered. Crucially, Presiding Officer, it must make sure that local authorities have the money they need to meet their commitments and address the blight of homelessness in regions like Glasgow and across Scotland. We must all work tirelessly to do this so that homelessness no longer exists and every person has a safe, secure, affordable and accessible homes. I and my colleagues on these benches will do that, and I hope that others across the chamber will do the same. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Duncan Clancy. And I now call on Shona Robertson, Cabinet Secretary, to wind up on behalf of the Scottish Government. Up to 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think, unfortunately, this debate, and I think probably the next one as well, can be summed up by some of the Tory speeches essentially being against anything, attacking everything, no positive ideas, voting against every measure, like short-term lets, like helping tenants afford their homes and prevention of eviction, even NPF4. And yet they come here and lecture us on poverty and deprivation. They have absolutely no sense of self-awareness whatsoever. I want to move on to the housing budget because it's important, as I had explained to Miles Briggs at the committee on Tuesday, and unfortunately he obviously didn't listen, about the reality, the facts of the housing budget. The housing budget remains the same at £3.5 billion over the course of this Parliament. The profiling of that budget will vary from year to year. Willie Rennie is not correct about £112 million cut. There is a net decrease of £36.87 million, a 4.7% net decrease on the published capital figure previously, mainly due to cuts in the capital budgets from the UK government and the challenges that brings. However, as I set out to the committee on Tuesday, that is being offset by financial transactions, a £15 million transfer from the energy budget and income from charitable bonds. But the £3.5 billion commitment for the housing budget remains the same over the course of this Parliament. Yes.
Miles Briggs.
This intervention. I don't think her own colleagues actually bought what she was saying at committee either, to be quite honest, and we need to make sure that we get more clarity on exactly where the government thinks a cut is not a cut, when it certainly is. But can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, in terms of this first debate, how bad do things have to get in Scotland for you to recognise that there is a homeless emergency today?
And I would remind members we need to speak through the Chair, Cabinet Secretary.
First of all, I'm happy to provide any information about the housing budget, and the £3.5 billion investment will remain the commitment over the course of this Parliament. I have never shied away from the fact there are challenges, but the Tory party in here, and every Tory member, not one of you has had the guts to address the cost of living crisis. You try to airbrush it out of every debate and it doesn't wash, because if you ask people out there, they know who is to blame for their financial circumstances that they face at the moment. And it is those sitting over on the left of this chamber, ironically. The other area I want to tackle today is the issue of delivery. And here is the stark contrast and the facts. Across the 4 years between 2018 and 2022, Scotland has seen 59% more affordable homes delivered per head of population than in England. We've also delivered over nine times as many social rented homes per head of population. I know the Tories don't like to have their own record of delivery exposed, but that is what it is. Now, I know it's a low bar. I know it's a low bar, but to have nine times as many social rented homes per head of population and, of course, per capita spending on affordable housing is more than three times higher than the UK government. So I'll take no lectures from the Tories on affordable homes whatsoever. Yes, we have more work to do to deliver more, and we acknowledge that, but I'll take no lectures from the Tories on this whatsoever. However, if the Tories want to know what they can do to be helpful, then there are some real practical things that they can do and have a word with their colleagues down south, because there are three areas that they could take action now to absolutely help to move more money into homelessness. At the moment, we are having to make £83.73 million available to local authorities to spend on discretionary housing payments, £69.68 million of that to fully mitigate the bedroom tax. That should be scrapped at source. An issue that I raised with UK government ministerial colleagues just this morning and asked them yet again to scrap that at source, because that money could then be moved in to addressing homelessness. £6.15 million to mitigate the benefit cap. Why don't the Tories scrap the benefit cap? That money could then be used for other purposes. And finally, £7.9 million to mitigate against the damaging impact of other UK government welfare cuts, including the ongoing freeze to local housing allowance rates. The Tory government has frozen local housing allowance rates for 3 years. 3 years, making it more difficult for tenants to afford their rents in all of the areas that the Tory MSPs represent.
Cabinet Secretary, not you will need to conclude.
Mention, not a mention of that today here. So why don't you have a word with your Tory UK government colleagues
Cabinet Secretary,
and get
you will
these
need to
things
conclude.
Fixed? And that will help the homelessness budget no end. Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And I now call on Jamie Green to wind up on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I stand to support the motion in Miles Briggs' names, as the cries of where's Willie ring out across the chamber. I'm sure you'll have a few words to say. Presiding Officer, there isn't much to be said. It's already been said in this short but important debate, a debate which Shelter said They were delighted to see being raised in the Parliament because the debate motions reflect many of the concerns that they hold, their own words. And I think that's something that members ought to have perhaps reflected on before some of the contributions that I heard today, because despite the inevitable cries of whataboutery and I'll take no lectures that we so often get from the government benches when we talk about serious social issues about this, I don't have a problem in saying that we are not in safe space. None of us are in safe space when we talk about issues like this. That is the whole point of using our debating time in this chamber to address these serious social issues. And that is why we make no apologies for raising it in the chamber today. We're using that time, that precious time, on housing and homelessness, which is why it's also equally depressing that there are so few members here to debate it with us. There are an estimated 47,000 homeless people in Scotland. But I do want to also point out that there are 600 homeless veterans in Scotland. And I would say to Graham Day, who validly make his point about all levels of government doing their very best for that cohort of people, I don't disagree. The worst thing the UK government did actually was sack Johnny Mercer as the Veterans Minister. The best thing it did was reinstate him back as Veterans Minister, because I believe that he's passionate about this subject. But as passionate as he is, he cannot magic homes in Scotland which do not exist, and that's the problem. Of course, homelessness is not unique to Scotland or the UK or indeed the Western world, but it is one that is acutely felt here due to the tragic consequences which it has. National Records of Scotland report that the homeless death rate in Scotland is 35.9 per million, and that is more than double the rate in England. Of course, it's not a race to the bottom, but that is a statistic which should concern us all. Consistently, drug misuse accounts for over half of Scotland's homeless deaths, a point made by Miles Briggs. You know, members are right to point out that this is a complex issue because poverty, addiction and some of those wider economic factors all do play their part in the scenarios that some people find in. And I do accept that many of these issues are governed by both devolved and reserved competencies. But it is simply wrong to say that this is a new problem which has magicked itself overnight. It's simply wrong to say that this is all Westminster's fault, it's all the Tories' fault. That's a very naive proposition because it does not admit that there is a problem that has been a long time coming in Scotland over successive years and successive cabinet secretaries in this government. But equally, homelessness can happen to anyone. This idea that it's somehow so only those on benefits or on certain social classes or structures will end up in that scenario is equally a wrong assertion, because anyone, a well-paid professional, can find themselves homeless. The breakup of a relationship, the loss of a job, a mental health breakdown, or finding themselves with an addiction problem. These are not unique to social class, but it is how we deal with these problems that matters, or as the case may be, how we are not dealing with these problems. Building new homes, of course, is not the silver bullet. I admit that, but it is a good start, Cabinet Secretary. Shelter Scotland raised alarm bells as far back as August last year with us when they told us that due to drastic underfunding of local councils, they are having to turn homeless people away. Some of them are being sent to England for help. They pled for the First Minister's help. They called on her to get a grip of the crisis. Let's think about that language, the crisis, because it is a crisis, I would say. Homelessness is not just about sleeping rough. There are huge amounts of people and temporary accommodation, as we've heard today. There are many couch surfing, are relying on their friends just to get by. The implications of this are huge. Homeless children miss an average of 55 days school per year. Due to disruption, homeless people are five times more likely to be admitted to a mental health facility. They're twice as likely to end up in AE. And the shocking statistic that we heard from other members is that the average age of death for a homeless woman or man is just a few years older than I am, and that is something that should shock us all, but it is fixable. Let's reflect when COVID landed upon us. Many of us were in the chamber passing legislation at the time. What did we do? We managed to clear the streets of homeless people in a week by offering safe sanctuary under the premise of a pandemic. Everyone who wanted one had a roof over their head. Why did it take a pandemic for our collective willpower to get that fixed? And why were so many turfed out back in the streets at the end of the emergency? You don't need to build new homes to deal with that. All of us should have been shamed into that scenario. The fact that there are homeless people out there right now who had a roof over their head during COVID is a great source of shame on this Parliament. You don't need to build new homes. There are already homes out there, I would say. There are 67,000 unoccupied homes in Scotland. I spoke to Housing Association in Greenock, who are baffled They've got excess stock. I haven't got time. They've got excess stock, but they simply haven't got the funding packages in place to refurb them and get people into them. Ukrainian refugees living on boats, families living in bedsits. We've got the stock, they said, but the councils haven't got the money, they said. And that's your problem right there in that one sentence. The problem is piling up. The amount of time taken to get out of temporary accommodation is increasing. The amount of children in temporary accommodation is increasing. The amount of people on social housing lists is increasing. And we've got people entering the system, we've got people stuck in the system, and there's a severe lack of housing available. If that is not an emergency worth debating, then I do not know what is. And if it's not an emergency, then how bad does it have to get to be declared one? I'll close simply with this. All of the charities involved in this sector are doing great work. Shelter Crisis, Homeless Project Scotland. But they care less about the politics of this, and they care more about the outcomes. They simply want politicians of all colours to listen to them and to act. We are listening, but is the government acting?
Thank you, Mr Green. And that concludes the debate on homeless emergency, and it is now time to move on to the next item of business. I'll allow a very short pause for frontbench teams to change position. Thank you.